I was thinking when you told about the, thank you very much. First of all, I would like to express
my big gratitude
for all the Institute of Advanced Studies staff for inviting me to speak here, for parents, for Jordi, and for all the colleagues I knew much earlier than we got acquainted with this possibility. I have been here speaking last year already, and have been listening to very interesting discussions. So this is an honor for me to be present here in a very interesting intellectual Central European club, really. A historically important place, just the place on the Austro-Hungarian border when all this process of dismantling the previous system has started. And I feel today that it started then, and the working out on the most urgent problems of the current time is continuing here. So my best congratulations for this success of the Institute, and I wish it further success, more followers, more students, and to acquire more strength and force and more interesting discussions, because if returning to our yesterday's meeting, you're there to discuss such questions we are somehow a little bit cautious about the current day existence, about the perspectives. We were brave enough to ruin the past, what we thought for the better, and now we're somehow standing in front of the problem what to do further on. It's very important to make a good expertise, to make a good analysis, but it is much more important to think over how to come out of these certain situations, because currently we are living, this is a very particular year, by the way, in the history of Europe and of Russia and the world. First of all, this year the European Union will celebrate the 25th anniversary of its functioning. So it was established at the end of the 1991. Then it was established, signed in 92, and in November 93 a start was launched for this big project. And 15 years, next year will be 15 years since the countries of Central Europe, Hungary, Czechia, Slovakia have become a part of the European Union. And very many things which were foretold as to the possible partnership of the Central Europe inside the entire European Union were very predictable. Very many have foretold that the less successful might be Poland, and it will take some 50 years for it to become an equal member of the European Union. Hungary will be the quickest one, and at least 25-30 years will need to be on the even foot or even handed with the European Union, but the process came much quicker than they have expected, and we should say that these countries have succeeded much more quickly, economically, politically, and certainly there was one important premise for it, that they had chosen a stable, economically, socially, politically developed integration, as they thought in 1991. Just some three, 4 days before last week, because We in Moscow have now a great international event, and very many European officials are coming to Moscow. Not everyone make their visits official, so I had a chance to be invited for a discussion with one of the vice presidents of Mrs. Mogherini, and he asked me, why you Russians do not want to follow our way, our European Union pattern? And I had to keep silence for a moment, because we seem that now it is exactly the European Union who is taking the part of the former USSR, considering your disappointment between what path are taking the relations between Brussels and the national states. Because really, there were some preconditions for the states of Central Europe to become its members. But finally, many of those states have become members with which it did not went all this way up to the end, and so preconditionally they were accepted. And let's say Hungary was accepted with the constitution, if I'm not mistaken, of 1949, with some modifications to it, 5 or 7 modifications, considering the its entering NATO, European Union, and so on. Many countries wanted to modify some of the laws they didn't manage to do before becoming the members of the European Union, and it turned out that being the members of the European Union, they cannot do nothing without some without the allowment from coming from Brussels. Well, in this respect, the situation is very much like it had been in the USSR, while the republics have finally have taken the decision to dissolve, and in 1991, so all these big space, so in a pink-red color still big enough, this is what has remained of the former USSR with its 15 republics. Some say that we are disturbing all the European Union and working it somehow on some, drawing some contradiction lines inside it. No reasonable, no Russian of reason would ever dream of such things, and I would rather say that, we live in a world of fake news, and I would really, yes, alternative news. This is a very mild definition, because there is really no alternative today for those countries, because Russia also is trying to build some space integration around it, and it doesn't manage even with the participation of the former states. Recently, last week, there was a meeting with the most truthful member of partner of Moscow with President Lukashenko in Minsk, and we are very sad to notice that this existence of the two poles on the map of Europe, of the Brussels successive economically, and Moscow, which is successful not in all fields, in the oil and gas production mostly, they have to choose. And unfortunately, this Russian alliance with China is a conventional alliance, I would say, because Russia is a European state, at least when some journalists sometimes come into Moscow and asking us, you Russians, how do you perceive yourselves? Do you belong to Asia or do you belong to Europe? I always give an answer that from kindergarten years, from our childhood, we were starting teaching the history of Europe, of Greece, of Rome, of Western Europe, and China, it is something to be institution years and so on. So we were brought up in this understanding that Russia is a part of Europe, though when experts ask, and there was a very popular discussion, Russia, what is it? Is it Europe? Is it Asia? Or is it Eurasia? Well, Russia is Russia as to its way of development that it is seen here, because if we come back to the thoughts of the old Russian geopolitical thinkers, they have thought that for Russian it is most important to unite two parts of the country, the European and the Asian, and they had never spoken that China is a part of this Eurasian idea as it is currently done. So Russia has, the first task for Russia is to consolidate itself, to return to the part of intensification of its economic development. Unfortunately, it has lost last year's much of its innovational potential. Very high is migration among the young members, the professionals who now work on the intellectual potential of other countries, including the United States of America still. Russia, not once in its history, was starting with a lower position, and then showed some growth, and there were periods when, at least economically, it managed. Very much is, I didn't tell at the very beginning that, Mr. Professor Ms. Levitz have told at the very beginning that I'm coming from the Institute of Europe and I'm chairing the Russian Institute of Europe, and I'm chairing there the Department for Central and Eastern Europe. And I brought here a number of our editions, how we do manage. There is the issues where Professor Ms. Levitz is published, where Attila Polk is published, and this is our own publication where we study the processes which are taking place here in Europe, and we have our own vision, estimation, economically, politically, and until now we had estimated it as a success. I would like to present it to the library that he asked, and
then later on to the authors.
I'll show you now. Russian is becoming again a popular language.
Yes, yes. But in a book there are some articles in English as well, at least the students who do not know. But you know, when some country is in economic decline, it immediately is followed by its decline in the sphere, in interest towards the development that's in its country. So I think that whatever we would speak about Ruski Mir, the Russian world, if economically we are poor, then no Russian world will be popular among the rest of the world. So about our relation of Russia with the European Union, another good question when we have been discussing about our current Russian relations with the European Union, what might be the relations between us? It is clear that we cannot be a part of the European Union. Only infrastructural funds will absorb all the money of the European Union.
Maybe the other way around.
other way around, but we do not have such intentions currently. We just think how to build up ourselves again, but there have been really, I would call it an era of flourishing in European Union and Russian relations that was somewhere in the end of 1990s, the beginning of the first decade of the 21st century, where the European Union and Russia has worked out these politics of the four common spaces, and they had been successfully moving forward, and at least this policy helped Russia to take calmly the very process of the Central European countries of Hungary, Poland, Czechoslovakia for becoming the parts of the European Union. As soon as this has been done, then this policy has been substituted by a policy which made a very deep crisis which cannot be overcome up to our days. This is the policy of the Eastern Partnership. And the European Union has the neighborhood policy, so the Eastern Front, both the Southern Front of the European Union. This is to our estimations, as we see from Russia, they were not very successful in fulfilling this policy, especially when such a big problem has been had arisen in between us. This is the problem of Ukraine, and it will take decades for solution. So we have somehow tried to return, and that was one of my propositions when I was asked how do we see the possible way of cooperation, let's say, I say the same for Central Europe and for the European Union, to think about the common neighborhood policy, because if we see the migration from Ukraine, then it goes both westwards and eastwards. It doesn't go one direction, so still both of the directions are chosen. So we have again to make a good expertise, to make a good analysis, and really to sit down to one table. Probably the EAS will bring us to this table, and to start thinking of how further, how to go on further for solving these problems we had lived through these years. And especially if we, do I have?
No.
Very little, a couple of minutes, a couple of seconds.
We lost one of the panelists for the next session, so we have a little more time.
Yeah, so I'm finishing now. This year, beside the jubilees I have mentioned, the jubilee of the European Union, and certainly it has lived its 25 years in one direction. So to think over how to live further, because these countries of Central Europe also have their propositions. Probably the next presidency of Austria in the European Union, from this point of view, is a symbolic one, because well, historical experience is that the Visegrad Group exists, the Slavkov Cooperation also exists, the Central European Initiative, where the Austria plays a very prominent part. Besides, we have a jubilee, 1918, very sad, 1938, 68, 1988. So these magic eights bring us to some thinking about what were people striving for in the last century. And we in Moscow in autumn will organize a conference which will be dedicated to these strives and aspirations of the peoples of Europe and Russia. They had in the 20th century, they did not manage to realize, and they have to think of currently. I have much more here to say, but I would prefer to answer if there will be the questions. Thank you very much for giving me a chance.
Thank you. Again,